I know that normally we take a book and we try to go through it because I just love to do that. I think it's an important way to study the Bible. I think it's an incredible thing to do. And I love it. I do. I have always felt a special sense of what God does in my life when I've just yielded myself to the Word of God in such a pure way. It's not that there are other ways to do, that's not the point. The point is, it's just that. But I'm going to do something a little different tonight. I just feel compelled to do this. So I'm going to read a few Psalms to start with, and you guys can read along with me. And I'm gonna start in Psalms 33. This is where I'm gonna start. I want to look at some whole psalms. You know, the Word of God is so rich and so powerful. It starts out and says, "Rejoice in the Lord." It's a command. "O ye righteous, for praise is comely for the upright." You know, there is nothing in that that we have of ourselves. Our righteousness is in Jesus. Our rejoicing is in Him. Everything. But He commands us to do it. And He has freely given us all that we need to do it. It's there. We can do this every moment of every day. Amen. We can get in the habit of rejoicing all the time. Not because things went good for us today, or not in spite of the fact they, quote, went bad for us today, but because of who He is. We rejoice in the Lord. Lord, You're so good. Your way is so wonderful. Rejoice in the Lord, oh, You righteous. You made me righteous, oh God. For praise is comely for the upright. It's a beautiful thing to stand before God pure and holy in Him because He washed you clean. You stand there and say, Lord, I thank You for the blood, and I've entered into Your presence, and Lord, I praise You. Praise the Lord with harp. Sing unto Him with the psaltery and an instrument of 10 strings. Sing unto Him a new song. Play skillfully with a loud noise. I mean, these are all the ways we're supposed to do this, you know. It's like we don't want people up there, I'm going to praise the Lord, and then they're striking all the wrong notes. Okay? Because He says right here, if you're going to do that, play skillfully and play loud. That's another interesting one. I really want the music to be soft. But the scripture tells us, play with a loud noise. That's pretty impressive. You got to think about these things. For the word of the Lord, it's right. And all His works are done in truth. He will not do them in falsehood. He will not join with my falsehood. He will not. He still loves me. But He will not join with my falsehood. If I hold in my heart falsehood, He can't join with that. What's the cure? What's the cure? Let's keep reading. Because I tell you what, the Bible always cures itself. Right? The word of the Lord is right. All His works are done in truth. He loves righteousness and judgment. The earth is full of the goodness of the Lord. By the word of the Lord were the heavens made, and all the hosts of them, by the breath of His mouth. He gathers the waters of the sea together as a heap. He lays up the depth and storehouses. Let all the earth fear the Lord. Let all the inhabitants of the world stand in awe of Him. I'll tell you, that'll cure your falsehood right there. Remember Job, a very righteous man, declared by God to be perfect. I mean, that's righteous. A man who was sincere, who followed after the word of the Lord, who wanted to do everything that was right. He was a man of integrity. And yet when he stood before God in that place of awe with the world standing on, when he saw God, when he forgot about all of him, you know, his complaint, and he had more reason to complain than most of us. He just lost his entire family. He lost everything he owned, and he was sitting there with his skin. He lost his skin. I mean, try to imagine that. Okay, he lost everything. He lost way more than any of us ever thought about losing. And yet when he saw God, he just so in awe of Him. I tell you, that'll cure your falsehood. That will cure your falsehood. I need to fall down before Him every day, broken before Him, crying out, oh Lord, I've got to see You. I've got to see You. I heard Pastor Mark say last night, he said, when when many of these men of God stood before God and they, like Moses, I want to see your glory, and God says, you'll die. It didn't even enter into the equation. He didn't even care that he would die. That wasn't even something that mattered to him. He was so desperate to see God. Are we that desperate? Or do we hold on to our life? Look, I can't tell you what you do or don't do. I just can't. But I can see this and begin to tell you what's going on with me and tell you, Lord, I want to see you. And I don't care if I die. Amen. I want to see you. Amen. I want to glory in you. I want to know everything there is to know about you. Because you are so wonderful. And I want to declare it from the rooftops. I want to declare it in the valleys. I want to declare it on the mountains. I want to declare it where there's lots of people. I want to declare it where there's one. I want to declare how wonderful you are. Lord, I must see you. I must see you. He looks at them and he says, let all the world stand in awe of him. Because I'll tell you what, right now, anybody can. All you have to do is believe, and all you have to do is want to. For he spake, and it was done. He commanded, it stood fast. You got falsehood in you? You got a problem in you? You got a weakness in you? You got a failure in you? Look what he does. He made the earth with one word of his mouth. He'll fix your problem with one breath that he speaks, or one breath that he blows. I don't care what it is, he'll fix it. He'll make it right. Why? Because that's who he is. This is declaring who he is. He spake and it was done. He commanded. It stood fast. You say, Lord, I can't stand. I keep falling. Let him speak. You'll stand fast. He'll declare it and it'll happen. The Lord brings the counsel of the heathen to nothing. He makes the devices of the people of no effect. You say, well, Lord, I can't stand. I can't make it. It's just so overpressing. It's just too much going on. When he speaks, look at the counsel of the heathen. It just fades away, and he makes the devices of the people no effect. They can do everything they want to do to strip you up. They can do everything they want to get you snared up in the world. It will have no effect. All you have to do is stand and look at him. Amen. Lord, I'm going to look at you. I'm going to stop looking at me. I'm going to stop evaluating me. I'm going to stop judging me. I'm going to stop saying, who am I, Lord? I can't do anything. Yes, you're right. Now fall upon the rock, be broken. He'll lift you up. And now everything you have is in him. And you don't care anymore. You just don't care. You don't care about things of this earth. The counsel of the Lord, verse 11, stands forever. And the thoughts of his heart to all generations. Blessed is the nation whose God is the Lord, and the people whom he has chosen for his own inheritance. Who is that nation today? Anybody know? We know it was Israel at one time, right? Everybody knows that. Who's the nation today? It's the church. The church is that nation that he called. He said, I will take away from you, Israel. I'm going to give it to somebody else. Who did he give it to? He gave it to Jesus and the nation that is born of him. That is called the church, right? That's who it is. So are you part of the blessed is the nation whose God is the Lord? Amen. Yes. Amen. I'm part of that nation. Amen. I'm part of that nation. I'm blessed because my God is the Lord and I'm part of this nation. And he's chosen me for his inheritance. Whoa. The Lord looks from heaven and he beholds all the sons of men. We think he doesn't see. He sees. He sees all the sons of men. From the place of his habitation, he looks upon all the inhabitants of the earth. He fashions their hearts alike. He considers all their works. There is no king save by the multitude of a host. A mighty man is not delivered by his much strength. The horse is a vain thing for safety. Neither shall he deliver up any by his great strength. Behold, the eye of the Lord is upon them that fear him, upon them that hope in his mercy. What's the fear of the Lord? To hate evil. What's the beginning of wisdom? The fear of the Lord. To hate evil. It's where we begin. But it's also wisdom to win souls. And we demonstrate how unwise we've been when we do not see the souls coming in. Now, it's very important because many times you find yourself beating yourself over the head, feeling like you're complete and utter senseless loser. There's a good place where you're crying out to God saying, Lord, I am unable. I can't do it. I have no ability. That's good. And it's real. And it's raw. And it's where it's supposed to be. But he's given us freely everything that he's got. He's given us all the power, all the authority. We just have to yield to it. So we begin to cry out, Lord, I got to see you. Because when I see him, and I stop seeing me, and I stop seeing them, I see him and what he wants to do. I tell you, it's a breakthrough. We begin to see it happen. Our soul, verse 20, waits for the Lord. He is our help and our shield. So you stand in a place where you think there's no hope, there's no safety, there's no way you're going to get through it. You put your trust in the Lord. You look up to him. You begin to say, let's see what God will do. We cry out to him. Say, Lord, do it in us. For our heart shall rejoice in him because we've trusted in his holy name. We just begin to rejoice in him because we've trusted in him. And we're just so excited about it. Let thy mercy, O Lord, be upon us according as we hope in thee. Are you hoping in me? Am I hoping in me? I'm of all men most miserable. Because if I'm hoping in me, I'm going to be a mess. I'm going to fail utterly. But thank God for his mercy that if I'll just turn my focus, I'll deny myself, I'll turn my thoughts to him, and I put my hope in him. I tell you, he says, your mercy is mercies upon me. That's amazing. It's amazing. Hallelujah. Psalm 34. I got to read this one too. I will bless the Lord at all times. Remember the first one said, rejoice in the Lord. I will bless the Lord at all times. His praise shall continually be in my mouth. So if I find myself in a place where praise is hard to come by, something's seriously wrong. What do? Repent. Cry out. Oh God, fill my mouth with praise that I might worship you. My soul shall make her boast in the Lord, and the humble shall hear thereof and be glad. Oh, magnify the Lord with me. Let us exalt his name together. I sought the Lord. He heard me and delivered me from all my fears. They looked unto him and were lightened, and their faces were not ashamed. This poor man cried, and the Lord heard him and saved him out of all of his troubles. The angel of the Lord encamps round about them that fear him, and he delivers them. Oh, taste and see, the Lord is good. Blessed is the man that trusts in him. Oh, fear the Lord, you his saints. There's no want to them that fear him. The young lions do lack and suffer hunger, but they that seek the Lord shall not want any good thing. Remember, I said he's given us all good things to enjoy. Right? That was the word I got to start with. He gave me all good things to enjoy. Oh, hallelujah. Verse 11, come ye children, hearken unto me, I will teach you the fear of the Lord. Amen. What man is he that desires life and loves many days that he may see good? Keep your tongue from evil and your lips from speaking guile. Depart from evil, do good, seek peace and pursue it. Amen. The eyes of the Lord are upon the righteous and his ears are open unto their cry. The face of the Lord is against them that do evil to cut off the remembrance of them from the earth. The righteous cry, and the Lord hears and delivers them out of all their trouble. Now, the Lord is nigh unto them that are of a broken spirit and saves such, a broken heart, and saves such as be of a contrite spirit. Broken heart and a contrite spirit. What does that look like? Is it something that you can fashion in yourself to create something that men will see and believe that you have? No. It's your relationship with the Father. And when you live your relationship vicariously through somebody else and the approval of men, no matter how glorious they may be, you miss it. Broken spirit, broken heart, and contrite spirit is before the Lord crying out, Lord, I can do nothing. And knowing it's true. And you're crying out, Lord, If I mean, I've even been at the place, Lord, I feel like I can do a lot of things, but I know that I can really do nothing. Lord, help me to see how nothing I can do. I mean, God's into truth. He's not into you making it up. I'll say the words, whether I believe them or not. No, you need to believe them. It needs to be real to you. So, but if you're having trouble with being real to you, where do you go to make it real? Well, we read over here, he's the one who speaks in truth. We call on him, he'll speak the word, and boom, he'll make us stand fast. He does miracles. He can do a miracle to keep you when you don't even want to be kept. It's amazing. How many times have we heard stories of women of God cry out for their children when their children didn't want to be kept, and yet the child was kept because the mother wouldn't stop praying. I mean, just an example. And there's many other types of examples. But I think it's important that we understand a broken spirit, and he saves such as be of a contrite heart. That's ones that look at themselves and they see nothing valuable because they're just looking at him and going, Lord, you're everything. You're everything. Many are the afflictions of the righteous, but the Lord delivers them out of them all. Amen. He does that. Amen. He will. I mean, afflictions are going to happen to the righteous. He made me righteous, and yet afflictions come. He delivers me out of all of them. He delivers me out of all of them. All I have to do is call upon him, put my trust in him. He keeps all his bones. Not one of them is broken. Evil shall slay the wicked, and they that hate the righteous shall be desolate. The Lord redeems the soul of his servants, and none of them that trust in him shall be desolate. It's amazing, isn't it? It's glorious. Let's go look at Psalms 57. I mean, I could just keep reading right where we were, but I want to look at Psalms 57 because we're going to get back to a similar theme. It's a slightly different beginning. Remember the first two we read, it was rejoice in the Lord and bless the Lord at all times. These are commands to us, and it's wonderful. Here's one where David is crying out because he's in one of those many of the afflictions of the righteous times, right? And he's running. He's running from Saul. Saul's trying to kill him. And Saul's the king, so he's pretty powerful. So, you know, it's like, what am I going to do? Be merciful unto me, O God. Be merciful unto me. For my soul trusts in you. Yea, in the shadow of your wings will I make my refuge until these calamities pass over me. I'm just going to cuddle up with you, Lord. I'm going to get closer to you. I'm just going to cry out to you. I'm just going to say, Lord, I need a greater relationship with you. Lord, I need to see you more clearly than I've ever seen you. Lord, I just need more of what you've got to give. And Father, I have nothing. I have nothing. I have nothing to offer you but all of me. Ever take everything. I will cry unto God Most High, unto God that performs all things for me. Because I can't take it into my own hand. I mean, you look at David in this time. He had the opportunity twice that we know of to just kill Saul. Now understand that this is the way it would have been done. If you study as much ancient history as I have, you find out how many times kings get taken over because their kids or their relatives, their nieces, nephews, whoever, some other noble just kills them. How many kings have lost their kingship because they were getting old and somebody just snuck up on them, killed them, and took over the government and said, now I'm the king. Okay, this was not an unusual way in which kingship passed from one king to another. It even happened in Israel and in Judah because of all the things, right? But if you study ancient history, it was like Israel and Judah were like good examples. They did better than most of these countries did. And so he's sitting there. He was the son-in-law of the king. And everybody in the court knew he'd been mistreated. I mean, it was pretty obvious. All he had to do was kill Saul. Just kill him. And he had the opportunity standing right there. He could do it. And then stand up and declare himself the righteous one, and the unrighteous one had perished because of his unrighteousness, and taken the kingship. And what would he have had then? Nothing. Nothing. So when he says this, he says, I will cry unto God Most High, unto God that performs all things for me. God would remove Saul when the time was right. And God would raise up David when the time was right. And he wasn't going to do it by his own hand. Now think about it for a moment. Take it into some other realm. Because the idea of murdering somebody is pretty anathema to most of us. We can't. I mean, even if we had the opportunity to kill Hitler when he was a baby, we just can't get over, you know, how do you kill something? Most of us have never killed anything, right? And we would just feel like, how in the world could we ever begin to do that? So let's try to take it into a different realm. God wants me to do something. He wants me to do the ministry. And I decide I have an opportunity to do it my way. I see something I can do that makes me feel good about myself. And so I go out and I'm going to take it in my own hand to do this thing. What am I going to have? Nothing. But if I fall upon my face before God, broken and contrite before Him, crying out saying, Lord, oh, forgive me for my being so slow of heart to believe and so slow to obey. But Father, I thank you that you've given me all good things to enjoy. You filled me with all your goodness, and you have made me one of the greatest soul winners in the nations by your help and grace. Lord, I deny everything of myself. I'm not going to take unto my own self, but neither am I going to sit on my rear end and do nothing. What I'm going to do is I'm going to stand up and begin to cry out, Lord, lead me. Lord, guide me. Let me follow you. And the Holy Ghost is going to show me where to go and what to do. But if I'm just sitting at home saying, well, Lord, I'm afraid to do anything because I don't want to take up and do the wrong thing, I'm going to do nothing, right? But I'm going to cry out to God and say, Lord, I don't want to do it in my own strength. But I'm going to move. All of you. But he performs all things for me. That's the point. He performs all things for me. Whatever my task might be. I want to see souls come into the kingdom. He performs that. He performs that. I just have to cooperate with him. He shall send from heaven and save me from the reproach of him that would swallow me up. Selah. God shall send forth his mercy and his truth. God's going to take care of it. His mercy and his truth. My soul is among lions, and I lie even among them that are set on fire, even the sons of men whose teeth are spears and arrows and their tongue a sharp sword. Be thou exalted, O God, above the heavens. Let thy glory be above all the earth. They have prepared a net for my steps. My soul is bowed down. They have digged a pit before me unto the midst whereof they are fallen themselves. Selah. My heart is fixed, O God. My heart is fixed. I will sing and give praise. Awake up, my glory, awake, psaltery and harp. I myself will awake early. I will praise thee, O God, among the people. I will sing unto thee among the nations. For thy mercy is great unto the heavens, and thy truth unto the clouds. That's why I can praise him, because I see him. Be thou exalted, O God, above the heavens. Let thy glory be above all the earth. So it ends this time with rejoice in the Lord always. And again I say, rejoice. Hallelujah. Father, I thank you in Jesus' name, Lord, for all that you do. Hallelujah. Let's read. Yes, Lord. Let's read Psalm 51. Have mercy upon me, O God, according to thy loving kindness, according unto the multitude of thy tender mercies, blot out my transgressions. So this is the prayer of one who feels like he's messed up. He knows that he has failed before God. And he cries out, have mercy. Because he knows something about God. He knows that he's merciful. Right? We read that earlier. He's merciful. He's full of mercy. Blot out my transgressions. Wash me thoroughly from my iniquity and cleanse me from my sin, for I acknowledge my transgressions and my sin is ever before me. Against thee only have I sinned and done this evil in thy sight, that you might be justified when you speak and be clear when you judge. Behold, I was shapen in iniquity, and in sin did my mother conceive me. Behold, you desire truth in the inward parts, and in the hidden part you shall make me to know wisdom. First thing I have to do is be truthful. I have to acknowledge my need. If I've done something wrong, I have to repent of it. I have to recognize what it is. If I find myself falling short, I have to begin to cry out to God, oh Lord, forgive me. What have I done? How could I do better? You begin to cry out to him, because sometimes we're just so clueless. We don't even understand what's going on. But he saw it. He saw it clearly. But what he said here, he said, verse 6, I desire truth in the inward part. You desire truth in the inward part. In the hidden part, you will make me to know wisdom. You need wisdom. He'll make you to know it when you truthfully cry out to him, Lord, I don't have any wisdom. My evidence is standing before me that my wisdom is failing. Praise the Lord for the wisdom to fear you The wisdom to say no to sin. The wisdom to hate evil. Praise the Lord for that. Thank the Lord. Glory in His name. Lord, where's the wisdom to see souls come into the kingdom? Well, He said here, He will make me to know wisdom. All I have to do is put my trust in Him. All I have to do is cry out to Him. All I have to do is be obedient to what He says to do. I can do one small thing and see the glory of God do great things. If it's just obedient. Purge me with hyssop and I will be clean. Wash me, I'll be whiter than snow. You know, He comes and does the washing. He'll wash you in the blood. You don't even have to do that part. Make me to hear joy and gladness, that the bones which has broken may rejoice. I want to, Lord, not only do I want to see, I want to hear You. We know He's always in joy and gladness. He's not in sorrow. He's not in sadness. He's not in fear. And so I say, Lord, I want to see You, and I might know Your glory. I want to hear You. Make me to hear joy and gladness, that all that's broken in me will be firmed up and strengthened. Hide Thy face from my sins and blot out all my iniquities. Create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within me. Cast me not away from Thy presence, and take not Thy Holy Spirit from me. In such a cry. Restore unto me the joy of Thy salvation, and uphold me with Thy free spirit. Then will I teach transgressors Your ways. Remember, He said, I'm going to make you to know wisdom. Then will I teach transgressors Your ways, and sinners shall be converted unto You. Does that sound like winning souls? Yeah. Yeah. Doesn't it? Deliver me from blood guiltiness, O God, Thou God of my salvation, and my tongue shall sing aloud of Thy righteousness. You know, Paul talked about blood dripping from hands because we've not ministered the gospel to people that have died and gone into hell. And their blood cries out and drips from the hand. And he says, deliver me from blood guiltiness, O God. O Lord, open Thou my lips, and my mouth will show forth Thy praise. For You desire not sacrifice, else would I give it. You delight not in burnt offering. The sacrifices of God are a broken spirit and a contrite heart. O God, You will not despise. Do good in Thy good pleasure unto Zion. Build Thou the walls of Jerusalem. Then shalt Thou be pleased with the sacrifices of righteousness, with burnt offering and whole burnt offerings. Then shall they offer bullocks upon Thine altar. If the heart isn't right, you could do all the law and it didn't do anything for you. Did nothing. We don't want to be those people. But look at the wisdom He just showed us, what He said to us. Here's what we do. When we talked about, we need the wisdom. He said, He's going to make me to know wisdom. And then for the rest of the world, what's He doing? Father, I need You. Don't cast me away. Renew in me. Strengthen me. Fill my mouth with good things. I mean, he just goes on. And then I can be the one who's why to teach transgressions Your way and sinners to be converted unto You. How long does it take? Doesn't take long. Doesn't take long. And then He will deliver me. So cry out to Him, O Lord, deliver me from blood guiltiness. It's a horrible thing when somebody falls. It's a horrible thing. A man of God stands up before the people, declares the righteousness of God, and then fall. It's a horrible thing. It hurts people greatly. It hurts people. We don't want to be those people either. So how are we going to prevent us being those people? We're going to stop trusting ourselves and trust only in Him. Everything we need, He gives. Every good thing He gives for us to enjoy. All the good things. And the good things of God are not the things of this earth. I mean, I'm thankful that He gives me food to eat, and I'm thankful that I have clothes to wear, and I'm thankful I have shelter. He told me I have need of these things. But that's not the good things I need. This is where, you know, people have recognized that the prosperity thing can go a little bit in the wrong direction, because you get to where we're so focused on, I need a fancier car and a bigger house and a boat and a whatever. I mean, I have nothing against any of those things. That's not the point, and we're not here to dig into that. But the point of it is that He's given me all good things to enjoy. Tells me He's given me righteousness. He's given me love. He's given me joy. He's given me goodness. He's given me, that's what He gave me. that I might have that, whether I'm rich in this world or poor, whether I have seemingly much or have little, you know, I'm content with whatever I got in this world, but I'm not content when I don't have what God gave me in the spiritual realm. He has given me all things that are of himself freely. He said to the woman at the well, who's five times degraded living with somebody who's not her husband, I mean, you don't hardly know anybody quite that messed up. He said, if you just ask of me, I'll give you to drink, and out of your belly will flow rivers of living water. And those rivers are rivers of love and rivers of joy and rivers of righteousness and all these things that we're talking about here. Sacrifices of God is a broken spirit and a contrite heart. Lord, that's all I want. And sometimes we get the idea that a broken in spirit and a contrite heart brings sorrow. It doesn't really bring sorrow, although you may be sorrowing over what you've done wrong. You may be in the repentance, oh God created me a clean heart, and there may be for the moment. But what it leads you to is a recognition of who he is and all the good things he's given me to enjoy. That's where, if it doesn't lead you there, it's the wrong thing. Godly sorrow leads you to repentance, and repentance gets you into the glory, right? So we have no excuse not to be in the glory. So then, Lord, how do I know? You know, we've tried so many times to measure ourselves, and as soon as we begin to measure ourselves like that, we got to do it according to the Word, yeah. Not according to anything else. What does the Word say? What does it say? What is it? How do we measure it? Verse 19, then shalt thou be pleased with the sacrifices of righteousness, with burnt offering and whole burnt offerings. Then shall they offer bullocks upon thy altar. You'll be pleased with these sacrifices. What sacrifice did Paul say that we needed to get? He said, be a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God. What's God pleased with? You give him all of you. That's what he's the only thing he's pleased with. He's really not pleased with a whole lot else. He's pleased when you give him all of you. He just said, Lord, I'm yours. Do with me what you want to do. Well, what's at your hand? Okay, take that up, do it. And then he began to speak with you. But when we've tried to do it our own way, and we've looked and evaluated with our own ability, and we've thought with what we think is good, we miss what we've been talking about. We miss it. When we come in here to worship, Wednesday night, how are you worshiping? Don't judge it too harshly. Don't get too wrapped up in it. Don't sit around wondering what everybody else thinks. Here's what you begin to do. Lord, I just want to see you, and I want to worship you for who you are. It's just that. It's just simple. It's that simple. Lord, that's what I want to do. I want to call upon your name, and I want to worship you for who you are. I want to begin to see you, and I begin to just glory in you, and just begin to talk about you, and begin to see you, and to begin to glory in you, and see you some more, and glory in you some more, and see you some more, and glory in you some more, and that's all you're going to do. That's all you're going to do. That's what we do. Hallelujah. Oh, Father. Let's look in Matthew chapter 5. Jesus, in verse 2, says he opens his mouth and taught them, saying, blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. I tell you, that's the broken spirit and contrite heart. You want the kingdom of heaven? That's what you want to be. It says, blessed are they that mourn, for they shall be comforted. What are they mourning over? That's the godly sorrow that leads you to repentance, as far as I'm concerned. They'll be comforted. You see, because God is not unmerciful, and he's not uncaring, and he's not unloving. If you've done wrong, and you're mourning over what you've done wrong, God will restore you. He will speak and you will stand fast. I mean, he will do it. So blessed are they that mourn. You need more mourn, but get out of the mourn because they're going to be comforted. Now be comforted, right? Blessed are the meek. They shall inherit the earth. Meekness is extremely important. Meekness has absolutely no, and we can fool ourselves into thinking we've been meek when we really haven't been. Meekness has absolutely no self-defense. None. There is none. Doesn't exist. No self-defense. You know, the Carlos Anacondia Spanish class, and some of you were in Spanish class, right? No existe. right? No existe. There's no self-defense in meekness. None. You don't see. You saw it in David. Lord, you take care of it. You plead my cause. You bring it to pass. He wouldn't take it into his own hand. He would not do it. He would not transgress the word of God. Do not touch my anointed. Do my prophets no harm. Would not transgress it. And Saul, I mean, to all of us who read the story, is like, goodness gracious, he needs to come down. We just need to end this thing right now. It needs to end. We need to vote him out of office. We need to, I mean, all natural thinking, you're going, what's goodness gracious that needs to be dealt with, right? If it wasn't obvious, certainly seems obvious now. David wouldn't do it. Why should we speak it? You just have no part. No part. Lord, you take up the cause. Lord, I plead my case before you. Lord, you are my defense. I'll wrap myself in your wings. I'll comfort myself with you. Right? This is what we're going to do. No self-defense. None. None. Too many of us, in my circles, it's way too much self-defense. Way too much explanation. Way too much of it. Just and all it genders to is strife. All it genders to is argument. Because I'm trying to defend myself and show you where you're wrong. Just cease. Blessed are the meek, they inherit the earth. Blessed are they which do hunger and thirst after righteousness, they shall be filled. The Lord is found of them who seek for him with all their heart. Somebody says, well, I'm having trouble finding him. I'm having trouble seeing him. Obviously, I'm messed up. I'm not doing it right. Well, it says right here, if you hunger and thirst for righteousness, you'll be filled. So if you're not filled, you're not hungering and thirsting. And you look at yourself and you reverse it on yourself. You go, okay, I'm obviously not hungering and thirsting like I'm supposed to. Lord, I don't know how. Lord, come help me. Deliver me from my stupidity. Deliver me from my inability. Deliver me from my failure. Lord, forgive me for my sin and teach me how to seek after you. Blessed are the merciful, they obtain mercy. That's the same thing as forgive everyone that does trespasses against you because God will forgive you. God says, I won't forgive you if you don't forgive everyone else. He just says it very clearly. You don't forgive, I won't forgive you. All you have to do is forgive. You just absolve everybody of everything. And not just one time. As often as it takes, over and over and over. Blessed are the pure in heart. They will see God. Pure in heart. Why? What's pure in heart? What's that really mean? That means your heart is fixed seeking God. You heard David say it. My heart is set upon you. So you're pure in heart. You're pure. You want no iniquity. You refuse all of it. The very thought of transgressing, as David cried out, against you alone, Lord, have I sinned. The very thought of transgressing against God begins to tear at your heart because it's so pure that when you see that, you don't want to have anything to do with it. Sin is so far from you. You can't even abide it. But yet, you love people so much that the sin doesn't affect you. That's why a prostitute could come into the room and fall upon the floor and begin to wash Jesus' feet with her tears and wipe it with her hair, and Jesus wasn't offended. The Pharisees were offended. They were upset over this display. Jesus wasn't upset. Not at all. Because he loved people so much. He also knew he knew how to deliver people. He had the answer. So he could take it away from them. It didn't matter what they'd done. It didn't matter how bad they'd been. He could take it away. He could make everything right. We should know that. We need to know that. So we're not afraid of people anymore. We're not afraid of how evil they are, how demon-possessed they are. We're just not afraid. We're not afraid to walk into a place with a bunch of sinners. We're not afraid. Because it doesn't have any effect on us. We're pure in heart. It doesn't affect us. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they'll be called the children of God. Peace. Blessed are they which are persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are you when men shall revile you and persecute you and say all manner of evil against you falsely for my name's sake. Rejoice and be exceeding glad, for great is your reward in heaven. for so persecuted they the prophets which were before you. You, the nation that God has bought with the blood of his own son, that he has given of the seed of Jesus put within your life, that you become that which comes out of him and you are made alive with him, that he's given you his very life. Those people, you are the salt of the earth. But if the salt loses its savor, where's it going to be salted? It's good for nothing but to be cast out and be trodden underfoot of men. I don't want to be that. I don't want to be salt with no savor. I don't. Lord, help me. I want to be salty. Lord, you are the light of the world, a city set on a hill. It cannot be hid. Put it up there. Everybody can see it from as far around as it is to see it. Neither do men light a candle and put it underneath a basket, but on a candlestick, and it gives light unto everyone in the house. So these are choices you make. You want to be salty? Stop covering up your light. Stop hiding in the shadows. Stop going in the caves. Stand up on top of the hill, get the basket off your light, put it up on a stick, and let everybody see it. Okay? I want to be salty, Lord. Well, don't have a light and hide it. Let your light so shine before men they may see your good works and glorify your Father which is in heaven. What good works are they going to see? Heal the sick, raise the dead, cast out devils. That's the good works. A lot of things we substitute, but that's the good works. They asked Jesus, well, what work do you work that we might know you? After he'd fed them all, he'd fed them with just a couple of loaves and a couple of fish. Well, what work do you work? You know, they're after him. They're trying to show us a sign. He said, no sign given to you. Sign of the prophet Jonah. After 3 days, I'll rise again. He said, I'm going to give you my life. I'm the bread from heaven. I'm going to give you my flesh to eat. I'm going to give you my blood to drink. I'm going to give you of me. That's the sign that you're going to get. But anyway, that they may see the good works. Think not, verse 17, that I'm come to destroy the law or the prophets. I'm not come to destroy, but to fulfill. For verily I say unto you, till heaven and earth pass, one jot or one tittle shall in no wise pass from the law till it is all fulfilled. Not one bit. Whosoever therefore shall break one of these least commandments and teach men to do it the same way, to break them, he shall be called the least in the kingdom of heaven. But whosoever shall do and teach them, the same shall be called great in the kingdom of heaven. In other words, we live by his word. And we speak it truthfully. We do not want to be those who change and alter it to fit our own personal desire. In any way. How do we keep that? Just stick with the word. Holy Ghost, he'll make it right. For I say unto you that except your righteousness shall exceed the righteousness of the scribes and Pharisees, you shall in no case enter into the kingdom of heaven. You got to have a greater righteousness. Was Jesus more righteous than the scribes and Pharisees? He gave you his righteousness. That's the righteousness you have. And so it better exceed. You have heard that it was said by them of old time, you will not kill. But whosoever shall kill shall be in danger of the judgment. But I say to you, I'm going to say this to you. Whosoever is angry with his brother without a cause shall be in danger of the judgment. And whosoever say to his brother, Raca, shall be in danger of the council. But whosoever shall say, thou fool, shall be in danger of hellfire. I mean, people have preached on this many times, but I mean, what he's talking about here is you're just casting people off, saying that there's no hope for you, is really what is going on. Well, there's no hope for them. I have many times been in situations where I don't know what to do. I can't help this person. That is wrong. Yes, I can't help that person, but Jesus can. And if I'm casting them off as unhelpable because I'm looking to myself to help them, I'm messed up. I'm missing it here. I'm missing it. I need to be saying in every situation, Lord Jesus, come. Lord Jesus, show yourself. Lord, Father, do miracles that Jesus might be glorified. Lord, because there's no one to cast off. There's no one to look at and go, well, they're hopeless. That's what he's talking about. Don't you ever do that. Even in your thoughts, if you hear the thought, cast it down. Because he says here that if you say, you fool, in other words, you useless, no way you can be saved, why would I even bother myself telling you about Jesus? You're in danger of hellfire. That's harsh, but we need it to be harsh to understand how awful it is when we've allowed ourselves to not preach the gospel because we assessed the person and judged according to our judgment and the way that we think and how we understand and came to the conclusion that there was no hope for them. That's horrible. When I heard that, I cried, I fell down on my face and began to just weep and cry, oh God, forgive me. Forgive me for holding back your word because I didn't have enough confidence that your word was powerful enough to make even the one who couldn't stand fast, stand fast. Because his word will do that. All we have to do is speak it. But just believe it. We know it's true. In Jesus' name, you will stand fast. Jesus' name, you will hear. In Jesus' name, the devils are broken off of you. Your ears are open that you might know who the God of your salvation is. That's what we're supposed to be doing. But we'll sit back and do it wrong. And here's where warning. Who's ever say, you fool? Oh, he's just a fool. No hope for him. In danger of hellfire. I don't want to ever even be coming close to being in danger of hellfire ever again. Never. Therefore, if you bring your gift to the altar and there you remember that your brother has something against you. You remember your brother has something against you. That means you've done something wrong to your brother. Do you understand? And you remember that you've done something wrong, leave your gift before the altar, go your way, be reconciled to your brother. Forgive your brother. Let him forgive you. Now you come back and offer your gift. That's a big one. Agree with your adversary quickly while you're in the way with him, lest any time the adversary deliver to the judge deliver to the officer, and you cast into prison. Come to agreement quickly. Verily I say unto you, you shall by no means come out of there until you've paid the uttermost farthing. It's in relation to the when your brother has something against you. See, if I owe Adam money and he holds it against me, or just I owe money, right? And I recognize that I'm harming him and he's got something against me and I'm causing him because I've not done what I promised I would do. I told him I'd give him the money, right? And it's causing him trouble. He says, your brother has something against you. I need to go and make it right quickly. That's what it's talking about when it says, agree with your adversary quickly. Get it taken care of. You go make it right. That's what he's talking about. If you understand. You go make it right. And it's not usually about money. It's usually about something else. But you go make it right. You have heard that it was said by them of old time, you shall not commit adultery. But I say to you that if you look on a woman to lust after, you committed adultery with her already in his heart. If your right eye offends thee, pluck it out, cast it from thee. For it's profitable for thee that one of thy members should perish, not the whole body should be cast into hell. What's he talking about here? We've all read all this stuff. If your right hand offend thee, cut it off, cast it from thee. For it's profitable for thee that one of thy members should perish, not that thy whole body should be cast into hell. He's talking about your righteousness needs to exceed the righteousness of the scribes and Pharisees. I mean, this really was talking about. You need to avoid sin at all times. You need to do whatever it takes to avoid it. Right? It has been said, whosoever will put away his wife, let him give her a writing divorcement. But I say to you, whosoever shall put his wife, saving for the cause of fornication, causes her to commit adultery. Whosoever shall marry her that is divorced commits adultery. Wow. Again, you have heard that it has been said by them of old time, thou shalt not forswear thyself, but shall perform unto the Lord thine oaths. But I say unto you, swear not at all, neither by heaven, for it's God's throne, nor by the earth, for it's his footstool, neither by Jerusalem, for it's the city of the great king. Neither shall thou swear by thy head, because you cannot make one hair white or black. But let your communication be yes, yes, no, no. Whatsoever is more of these comes of evil. Just because when you forswear yourself, you're putting your trust in you. Question?
I have a question about the divorce.
The part about what? Which verse?
Divorce.
Divorce.
Putting away.
Yes.
So, I'm not sure if it says it here, but it says it multiple times in the Gospels about, like, if you put away your wife and your wife were to marry another, then her and the person, the guy that she married, they commit
Yes.
And there will be perpetually adultery. Is that correct?
What scripture are you referring to says perpetually in adultery?
Well, that's what I'm asking.
Oh, yeah. It doesn't. I don't know that there's any scripture that says it that way, because that doesn't come to mind. Father, in Jesus' name, I don't know anybody. One that says, and they will be perpetually in adultery. Divorce is a very sticky and difficult subject, especially in our world today. Always remember the love and the mercy of God. There was a woman who had been divorced 5 times, and they came to Jesus, and they tried to trick him by talking about somebody who, you know, got divorced, you know, married her brother, and then it was with all of them. And people get lost in trying to parse it all out and try to make it right. Let's look at it this way. We're the ones supposed to be standing in righteousness, and this is what we will do. I liken this similar to casting somebody out and saying, thou fool, and being in danger of hellfire. If my wife is having a lot of problems, and sometimes it's not my fault, and sometimes it might be, and sometimes I may be doing things wrong, and sometimes I'm not. If you come into my house and start pointing out, well, you must be doing it wrong, or you must be doing it right, you might be right or wrong most of the time, because you don't know. You're not that smart. I'm not that smart to figure all those things out. But God, when His word is spoken, and when my life is given before Him, everything in my life needs to be blessed. And if my wife is my own flesh, then she should be blessed. And if she's not blessed, then maybe I'm not blessed. And I need to get right with God. If my husband isn't doing what's right, what does the scripture tell her to do? Pray for him. If he pleased to dwell with you, go after it in God. See him come by the conversation of the wife, be one into the kingdom, right? So I liken it to that. The whole point of divorce is when God made a man and male, if he put them together, no man put it asunder. But he does give the same caveat that's in the law, which is, you know, for the cause of fornication, because of the hardness of men's heart, that if it's just so much that you cannot bear it, in that case, it is possible to put a wife away. It's what he says here. But God showed us how he took a woman out of prostitution, married her Hosea, had a bunch of kids, and she ran back to prostitution, of the worst kind. You know, not some high class whatever, some low class, really low, bad prostitution. And then God said, now go buy her. Go pay to her handlers, pay them the money it takes to get her for many days. Buy her for many days and bring her home to you. I mean, that's what God does, right? So when we think about divorce, so many people in the church have used it as a hammer to beat other people up. Point the finger. Call people, you know, in adultery and whatever. Look, be very, very cautious that you recognize what God's calling you to is husbands love your wives, wives submit to your husbands. You do that before God and you won't have to worry about it. Won't even be an issue. Somebody else is having a problem that you certainly do not understand, because I guarantee you don't understand what goes on in other people's lives. And you see somebody that ends up in a situation where the wife and the husband separate. In the worst case, repentance. You commit a sin, you can repent. And everything can be restored in some way. Remember the scripture says, if you have an unbelieving spouse and he is pleased to dwell with you, then continue to minister to him. But if he's not pleased to dwell with you, don't just let it go. You can let it go. I just want to be really cautious. We're going to bring up the divorce thing, that we remember in this context, there's a call for us to live righteously. And there's an understanding of what we're supposed to do. And one of the things that we're not supposed to do is inculcate ourselves into other people's lives and start pointing the finger. Jesus didn't look at the woman and say, man, you really have messed up. Five times? Five? One, not one, not two, five? That didn't even cross his mind. He just looked at her and said, if you knew who I was and you asked of me, I'd give you to drink, and out of your belly would flow rivers of water, and you'd never thirst again. That's the restoration that he promises, even in those situations. Is it righteousness to dwell with a wife, what God has put together, let no man put asunder? Yes, it is. And that's the way it should be. It is the way it should be. It's the way God made it. And so let's go after that. When you see somebody, but don't use it as a stick to judge somebody else. Do you understand what I'm saying? I'm saying it's very commonly a confusion because so many people have used it as a religious stick to beat people upside the head, not understanding what went on in people's lives and not knowing anything about it and acting as if they're the arbiters of what goes on with people. We can do that so easily. When we hear the call to righteousness, remember where your righteousness comes from. It isn't because of what you did. It comes from Jesus. And that person's righteousness needs to come from Jesus too. Now, if I was the pastor of the church or something, and I stood up here and I'm flaunting my adultery and I'm flaunting my divorce and I'm saying, oh, it doesn't matter. I'm done with this one. I'm going to marry the choir director. I mean, obviously, we can all look at that and go, it's like when Paul said, we got a man in the church who's with his father's wife. Now, it doesn't mean it was his mother, praise the Lord. But, I mean, he's with his father's wife. I mean, that's like disgusting that even the Gentiles don't like that. And you're allowing that in that he going, look, I don't have to even be there to judge. I judged already. That's bad. Let's deal with that. All right. There are some things that are so obvious that we should not see that. Correct? But still, as we talked about, Saul was messed up, demon-possessed, messed up. And David would not take it into his own hands to bring the judgment upon Saul. He did not. So, it is true. I want to say this again. What God has put together, he made the male and female from the beginning and said the two shall be one flesh. That is what God wants. That is God's way. That is God's righteousness manifested. It's the way it's supposed to be. And that's what we want. And we are not going to accept less than that. But neither are we going to find ourselves looking at somebody else, whoever they are, and looking at them with our stick of judgment and arguing over whether what they did was good or bad or right or wrong and whatever. That's not what it's for. No, yeah, right. I mean, there's repentance for sin. So, divorce is sin. So there's repentance for it. But there's also understanding, except for the cause of fornication is one that's given here. Do you understand what I'm doing? I'm painting these big strokes because I want you to recognize what often happens with people. And we can subtly fall into it and get upset about some particular thing that we don't like. And then go run around judging everybody over that one thing. Oh, you're bad. You're bad because you do that. You're really bad because you do that. Yet all the time, we're doing something else, like speaking evil of somebody behind their back or whatever. That's what he talked about the Pharisees. You know, you tithe, he said. You tithe of your mint and your anise and your cumin. I mean, that's their herbs and spices, you know. Think about, you just take a little bit of the herbs that you put on your food, and they took that and they divided it into 10 parts and made sure that a tenth of it was collected and given to God. That's how righteous they were. They were not going to violate the law of God. You give them some spices, just a little bit, they'll cut it down and they'll take a tenth of it out and make sure it gets given to the king. But you have left off the weightier matters of the law, righteousness and justice. Truth. You left those off. He looked at them and said, you're whitewashed sepulchres. You look good on the outside. Men will praise you for your righteousness, but inside you're full of dead men's bones. If you and I were looking at a Pharisee today, we'd be going, how righteous is that man? He is amazing. He's absolutely amazing. It takes the Holy Ghost to be able to see it and to call it out and manifest it. I want the Lord to manifest it in me as, you know, I'll take mine now. Lord, come judge me Come show me my sin. Show me what I've done wrong. Show me where I've failed. That's more important than, Lord, show me how to take my stick and beat somebody else over the head for what they did wrong. Because that's not what we're called to do. So, is divorce a sin? The answer is yes. The answer is yes. It's not the way God made it to be. You enter into a marriage, it's a covenant before God, most importantly. We also make it a covenant before men, and in our case, it's often a covenant before the government. Of course, that's worthless because they just made it to where it doesn't even mean anything anymore. But that's the levels of that covenant that you're making. Because, you know, when people have a wedding, what are they doing? They're declaring before all the people there that we're joining together. I want everybody to witness it so you hold us accountable to the fact that we're doing that, right? That's a good thing. But more important than anything is this before God. And God will keep you in it, and he will make it right if it's at all possible. But what you see here is there are some times where it is not possible. Am I going to tell you what they are and detail them out for you and explain to you? Well, here's the situations. I really am not, because I'm not that smart. I don't know. But I know this. God is merciful and loving. And what he has basically said about this is there are some situations that are so wrong that even here in Jesus saying, there are some situations where it's okay to put away a wife. That's pretty intense. Because I'm going to tell you, that takes a lot. But there are situations where it's okay. But even if it was, quote, we judge it in our pea brain as okay, it doesn't matter what I judge it. It matters what God judges. And God will take care of it. And my prayer in any situation I see that looks anything like that, my prayer is, Father, blessing. Lord, you come and you restore. Come and you make brand new. Lord, you make it right. Lord, you bless them. You keep them. You cause them to seek after you. Lord, you know, don't allow them to be damaged forever because of this thing that has come upon them. I mean, whatever. You pray a blessing upon them. And you don't sit around thinking about, boy, I tell you what, if they just were smart like me, they wouldn't have done. I mean, that's just dumb. That's how you get yourself into trouble very, very quickly. So, I'm sensitive to it a little bit because I remember 30 years ago, people just being beat up by this thing. You know, they'd been through a divorce and then they thought that somebody was telling them that what the scripture meant is they could never ever be married again. They could never, because if anybody married them, it'd be adultery and whatever. But I mean, this is somebody in particular I'm thinking of who'd been divorced when she was unsaved. I mean, she'd repented, been washed for sin, made brand new. I mean, did she have to go find that old husband, get him back, and then, no. But yet somebody's preaching to her, oh, you can only ever be married to that one, that first one. Well, what about the woman who had five husbands? Which one's she supposed to go back to? it gets absurd when you try to do that. So let's remember the one thing, mercy. Not judgment. That's where we live. Are there times when leadership in the church has to make a judgment and has to speak it? Yeah. But they have a special anointing to do that. Right? And that's not for us to be walking around doing. If we see a brother that's in a sin, should we go and try to restore them? Yes, we should. Why? Because we love them. And we see their need and we're trying to restore them. But we're not doing it to you're bad. What are you here? You're bad. You fool, get out of here. I mean, that would be awful if we even begun to do that. So I'm very sensitive when we bring up the divorce subject because I remember it was the first thing that I ever had to deal with in my walk with Jesus where I began to see the difference between taking the scripture and using it as a club against people and the love of God that wants to restore no matter what the situation was. And I watched it happen, and it was, and I mean, I was very young, and it was really hard for me to understand what was going on, and I wasn't married at the time, and I didn't understand much about it. And so I think it's very important that we not try to classify people with this scripture. You got it? Does it make sense? We just be really cautious about that, and we just recognize that, you know what? I'm going to do it righteously because I'm going to walk with God. And he's going to give me a wife if I need one, and one wife. And I'm going to walk with God. And I'm going to do it right before Him. Well, yeah, children come with that. So, and then but you understand, that's the call. And we see the call of God, and that's what we want to do. That's what we want to do. We do it right. So I spent way too much time on it, but I think it's important. And it sort of illustrates how sometimes people take the word of the Lord and they make it their own personal stick. And we don't ever want to find ourselves in that place. Just like we don't ever want to find ourselves in that place of calling somebody a fool or calling somebody vain and without hope, because it puts us in danger. Because if I believe what we read in Psalms, which is why I read it first, if I believe all that, I believe that the word of the Lord will come and make you stand fast. So if you're the worst sinner in the place, if you've got such weakness that you can't stand up, no matter what happens, you've been divorced 5 times, and you're just a mess in everything. By my judgment, I'd look at you and go, oh my goodness, that guy can't hold it together for anything. I'm wrong when I do that, but I'm right when I begin to say, the word of the Lord is, be strengthened and stand before Him and be thou perfect. Right?
Yeah.
That's what we want to be.
Amen.
We have to believe it. We have to know it's true, and it begins with me. Lord, I feel so undone. I feel so unable. I feel so absolutely without strength to stand before you. He'll come and strengthen you and cause you to stand up. That's what we're here to do. That's what we're here to believe. So anyway, Father, I hope that was helpful. I hope you see the difference of what Jesus is saying here. I swear unto you, verse 34, swear not at all, neither by heaven, for it's God's throne, nor by the earth, for it's His footstool, neither by Jerusalem, for it is the city of the great King. Neither shall thou swear by the head, because you cannot make one hair white or black. But let your communication be yea, yea, nay, nay, for whatsoever is more than these come of evil. And I was saying that the whole point is you put your trust in God, not in your ability to swear and make it happen. So I could say to you, I swear to you that tomorrow I will be here with what you need. I'll get my truck and I'll bring it over and I swear I'll be here. I'm putting it in myself when I do that. I'm committing myself to do that. That's wrong. What does he say that we're supposed to do? Oh, he says, but in another place, what he talks about, when he says, what should you say? Should you say, I'm going to go here and I'm going to do this? He says, no, if the Lord will. Because I belong to Him. I don't belong to me. A servant couldn't say to somebody, I swear I'll be there tomorrow, because the master said no, he wasn't going. Right? So the whole point of it, when you say yes, yes, no, no, what he's talking about is answer truthfully. And many times the answer would be, if the Lord will, I'll be there. Because we should be so led of the Holy Ghost, what we should be, so led of the Holy Ghost, that we only do what He gives us to do. And if we think, oh, but Lord, I swore myself, you shouldn't have done that. And there's a lot of dicey things get into that. How do I function in the earth? And how do I sign a contract? And, you know, I mean, there's a lot of things. But you must always, in your heart, Jesus, God first. It's God first, right? So let your answer, yes, no, speak the truth. Can you promise me that you will be there tomorrow? Well, no, I really can't. If the Lord wills, I'll be there. I want to be there, but I cannot promise you that I'll be there. I'll do my best to be obedient to the Lord. And if it's the Lord's will, I'll be there. And I can say, you've heard it's been said, an eye for an eye and a tooth for a tooth, but I say to you that you resist not evil. Whosoever shall smite thee on the right cheek, turn to him the other one also. If any man will sue thee at law and take away your coat, give him your cloak also. Whosoever shall compel thee to go a mile, go with him too. Give to him that asks thee, and from him that would borrow of thee, do not turn away. You have heard that it has been said, you will love your neighbor and hate your enemy, but I say to you, love your enemies. Bless them that curse you. Do good to them that hate you. Pray for them which despitefully use you and persecute you, that you may be the children of your Father, which is in heaven. For He makes His sun to rise on the evil and on the good, and sends rain on the just and on the unjust. For if you love them which love you, what reward do you have? Do not even the publicans the same? If you salute your brethren only, what more do you have than others? Do not even the publicans so? Be ye therefore perfect, as your Father which is in heaven is perfect. It means you love everybody. Love. The love of God is so great. What we do when we don't deny ourselves is we don't give room for the love of God to show. What we do when we look to ourselves to accomplish something, we don't give room for God to do it. We take away from the situation the ability for God to do it because we can do it ourselves. I got this one, God. And we don't realize many times that that's what we're doing. We think we're being responsible. We think that we're doing the right thing. We think that we're accomplishing something good. Don't get too wrapped up in it to where you're sitting there arguing with yourself all the time. Do good. Be quick to do good. Be quick to give. Be quick to pour out to people. Somebody asks of you, it says, give them. Give to whoever asks of you. I mean, somebody says, I need help. I need something. Give it to them. You have it? Give it to them. That's what you're supposed to do. Give it. You don't have to sit and, well, I'm not sure if it's the Lord's will. He told you. Give to them that ask of you. Just give it. Right? Whew. So verse 1 of chapter 6. Let's see how far we go. Let me just check something. I'm not going to read all of this, but let's just get started. Take heed that you don't do your alms before men to be seen of them. Otherwise, you have no reward of your Father, which is in heaven. Therefore, when you do thine alms, don't sound a trumpet before these hypocrites do in the synagogues and the streets. They make glory of men. Truly, I say to you, they have their reward. But when you do alms, let not your left hand know what your right hand does, that thine alms may be in secret. And thy Father, which sees in secret himself, shall reward you openly. And when you pray, you will not be as the hypocrites are, for they love to pray standing in the synagogues in the corners of the streets. They may be seen of men. Truly I say to you, they have their reward. But you, when you pray, enter into your closet. When you have shut the door, pray to thy Father which is in secret, and your Father which sees in secret shall reward thee openly. But when you pray, don't use vain repetition as the heathen do, for they think they will be heard for their much speaking. But not be not ye therefore like unto them, for your Father knows what things you have need of before you ask him. After this manner, therefore, pray. Our Father, which is in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Your kingdom come. Your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For yours is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. For if you forgive men their trespasses, your heavenly Father will also forgive you. He just did it twice. Jesus did a whole pair. How important is this? He did a whole parable on the subject. Yeah. He put it in the prayer. And then he said after the prayer, this is the most important part of the prayer. Forgive. And your Father will forgive you. Wow. That's intense. That shows you how important it is. You've been mistreated. Somebody's done something bad. And they really have. They've really done something wrong to you. They've stolen from you. They've taken from you. Forgive. 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 It's on them to come ask for forgiveness. But you forgive them before they even ask. You forgive them. You don't hold on to it. You don't allow it to become bitterness in your soul. You just don't. You forgive them. Forgive them. I mean, many times I've had to do that. And it's a very glorious thing when you just release yourself of it. Somebody owes you a lot. And they say, I mean, there's no way I can pay it. You say, fine, go. Because the first thing that comes to your mind is what your Father forgave you of. He forgave me a lot. Way more than anybody has ever taken from me. Way more. I mean, it's not even in the same stratosphere. It's so big compared to so little. That's what Jesus tried to show us in the parable. Forgive. Just forgive. Everything. No matter what men may do, you forgive. Forgive. And don't hold on to it. Don't say, I'm going to remember it. Lord, I just want to forget it. He's amazing, though. You know, he'll do that for you. He'll help you. When you say, Lord, I just forgive him. Lord, I just don't even want to remember it. He'll help you. He'll take it away. It's amazing. But if you forgive not men their trespasses, neither will your Father forgive yours. Moreover, when you fast, be not as the hypocrites of a sad countenance, for they disfigure their faces and appear unto men to fast. Verily I say to you, they have their reward. When you fast, anoint your head, wash their face, that you appear not unto men to fast, but unto thy Father which is in secret. And thy Father which sees in secret, he'll reward you openly. You say, well, I'm not being recognized and I'm not being rewarded. Maybe you're not doing that. I mean, you just get raw and honest before God. Lord, maybe I'm not doing this like I should. Maybe that's the problem. I don't even want to seek reward of men. But Lord, if I'm not seeing the wisdom, you promised me to give me wisdom. And you promised that then would transgressors be converted and sinners be changed. You promised me that. If I would do the things. So if it's not happening, then I'm not doing the thing. I'm not doing them. There may be some delays now and then. There may be some hindrances. There may be, fine. Whatever. But if I'm not seeing the fruit of it, I'm not doing it. It's as simple. And you can plead with people, plead your case, try to show them how you have. But Lord, didn't I do all these things? Oh, wow. Bad place to be. Don't ever want to be in that place. But Lord, didn't I do all these things? Depart from me, you that work iniquity. Ah! That hurts. I mean, that's about as awful as it gets. Could you imagine? I don't want to do more than imagine it. I don't ever want to be in danger of hellfire. I don't want to be in that place where the Lord's going to say, look, depart from me, you that work iniquity. I just never knew you. You didn't do what I commanded you to do. You didn't follow me. You didn't receive my life. You did yours. Lord, it isn't funny. It hurts. Oh, God. But he tells us right here, when you do these things in secret, Father will reward you openly. Lay not up for yourselves treasures upon earth, where moth and rust doth corrupt, where thieves break through and steal, but lay up for yourselves treasures in heaven, where moth nor rust doth corrupt, and where thieves do not break through nor steal. For where your treasure is, there will your heart be also. So I went really further than I wanted to go, but it's just you can't stop. And you guys all know, and you need to read those things more. I don't want to just keep on going, but I want to go back to the theme. God has given us all good things to enjoy. And he isn't talking about money and food and pleasurable times. It's not what he's talking about. Not that there's anything wrong with some of those things. God knows what you have need of. But he's given us all good things to enjoy. He's given us his righteousness, and he's given us his love. He's given us goodness. He's given it freely. Amen. It's yours. Amen. You don't have to earn it. You don't have to meet up to some standards of your own or somebody else's. You call upon the name of the Lord, and he will do it in you. He will bring it to pass, and it won't take a long time. It won't. It can take one simple act of obedience. Just do what he told you to do. If he told you to do something, do it. If he told you to stop something, stop it. If he told you to give something, give it. Just that simple. Just be obedient. Just do what he said. He's your provider anyway. Everything you have belongs to him. You want more of what he has to give? How do you get it? You ask him. Lord, I want to be more hungry. I want to be more thirsty. I want to be more desperate. Father, I want to be so overwhelmed with you that all I am consumed with is seeing you and hearing you. Lord, that your name would be glorified. Lord, that out of my mouth would come such a thunder of your word that men would be converted and sinners would know your ways. This is what you desire. Father, this is all I desire. Lord, help me desire it more. Lord, show me the things that hinder. Lord, show me things that get in the way. But Father, I'm not even worried about that. I'm just so consumed with you, I don't even care anymore about any of those things. I don't care about figuring it out. I don't care about understanding it. Lord, I just want to see you. Lord, I just want to see you. Lord, so broken before you, so contrite before you. Lord, so hungry for you. Lord, so desperate, oh God, to see your wisdom revealed. Lord, send forth laborers into your harvest. Lord, send forth laborers. Father, send them forth. Lord, let me help you them to go. But more importantly, Father, I want to be one. I want to be one. Lord, I want to be a laborer. I want to be one who goes. I want to be one who goes forth with your wisdom to speak forth your word in all the love that you have, in all the joy that you have, in all the authority that you have. Father, to speak your word and to see sinners converted and come into your kingdom. In Jesus' name, I pray it for all of us, Lord, that that would be our hunger, that would be our desire, that would be our prayer, that would be our pleading, that would be our desperation before you. Oh God, that we would not cast away these things ever again, that we would not allow them to languish, Lord, that we would not allow them to become less than what they are. But Father, with all our heart, we would cry unto you and say, Lord, I'm so desperate for you. So desperate. Have so hungered for you and have seen how much I have lacked, oh God, to do your will because I'm so consumed with my way. Father, in Jesus' name, let it never be another moment, another day, but Father, so hungry for you. In Jesus' name, amen. Father, I thank you for doing it. So what I desire, what I have desired for a long time is that we, you know, what this was supposed to be when we started on Saturday mornings, besides the fact that we just wanted to teach in a little different way, was a place to try to bring people that might not come to something else. You understand? It's just another vehicle of an entrance to bring people in. Hopefully not too religious of people, but you know, whatever, bring anybody. But pray with me. If you got somebody that, you know, that maybe they'll come on a Tuesday night to something. You know, sometimes people come to the women's ministry. Maybe you can bring somebody here just because they'll come on a Tuesday night just to talk about the Bible. That's the goal, is to give some place some people to come in and to be established. The other thing was, you know, just a desire to help people be established in the Word of God and to see it maybe a little bit different. So pray with me about that as we just see what the Lord will do. Right? Yes. Amen. Does anybody have any questions? I always want to, it's one of the other things, the other themes about this is just, first of all, questions about what we talked about. I'm glad you asked one. Questions are really big for me. I love questions. I love when people come and they go, I just really don't understand this. I need to know about this. I love that. Because what I found is that when people ask questions, I just say, well, Father, what would you say? And boom, there'll be an answer. A lot of times an answer I didn't even think of beforehand. I had no idea. So does anybody have any questions about what we read, Psalms or Matthew? And if not, does anybody have any questions about anything else? Ananias and Sapphira is how I always say it, but yeah, okay.
I'm just wondering, like, how come they were judged very hard?
Why were they? Well, I can't honestly answer to you everything about their life because the Bible doesn't reveal it to us. But Peter made the judgment very clear. He says, why do you lie to the Holy Ghost and to us? And Father, help us to understand that there are places that you're expected to go and places you're expected to know, and to whom much is given, much is required. And there is an authority and a judgment in the house many times. And what you see there is you see a people who were, I mean, the Holy Ghost is moving. They were having things in common. There was much, and yet these people represented something that wasn't true. See, they could have sold the property, given half to the church, and kept half for themselves, and said that's what they did, and they might have been fine. Because remember, he said to the rich man, sell everything you have, give to the poor, and come follow me. And then he said, Zacchaeus said, I give half of all my goods to the poor. And Jesus said, salvation's come to this house. I mean, it's like what we were talking about with the divorce things. We can take our stick, oh, you did, and you didn't, and we can judge things in that way, and we miss the point. So what we don't know is, what was it about the two of them? What was the place that they were standing before God? Who were they? What place did they have in the ministry? What understanding did they have? And they come before God and testify with their mouth to the Holy Ghost, because they understood, believe me, who was behind them. we sold it for $100. Here's the $100 when they actually sold it for $150 and they held $50 for themselves and didn't say that. And so they lied in the very, it's like walking up to the God in the throne room and going, Lord, I did it and you know I did it and that's the facts. And you didn't and you lying. I mean, just try, think about that. Stand before God, try to lie to him. And so the judgment fell and great fear fell upon the church. Because they began to understand at a whole other level that they're not dealing with men, they're dealing with God. When you come in here, you stand before God. You don't stand before men, you stand before God. That should incite in you a certain fear, right? And I have never heard, never, it doesn't mean it hasn't happened, I've never heard of another Ananias and Sapphira situation. I've never heard of one. Some other people who know more than I do about church history may could be able to tell you other stories. I don't know any. But when I read that in the scripture, it's very clear. Why did you conspire to lie to the Holy Ghost? That's what was put first. You lied to the Holy Ghost and to us. That's why they were judged. They knew exactly what they were doing. And judgment fell. Why did Nadab and Abihu die? I mean, God had just set up the thing. He just set it up. They just put it in place, told them what they were supposed to do, everything was put in place, and these guys offered strange fire upon the altar. And there's a whole lot, I don't want to go into all the details, but a whole lot of things that happened, right? And they were immediately judged. Boom! Dead. Fell down dead. God's presence. Just like that. That's the God we're dealing with. He's holy. He's holy. And in his holiness, no sin can abide. You come into his presence to give your gift. That's why he tells you, and your brother has something against you, go get it right. Go get it right. Just go get it right. Now come offer your gift. You come before the Lord in holiness. You come before the Lord in righteousness. He has not changed his mind. He still, when the high priest walks into the Holy of Holies, he had to be absolutely pure. He had a special sacrifice offering going on for him to make sure everything's right with him before he walked in and offered for the sins of the people. Everything had to be perfectly done, exactly right, to demonstrate absolute consecration before God. We still walk into that same Holy of Holies. So really, our heart has to be that. Lord, I thank you for the blood of Jesus. It's a great place to start. Lord, I thank you for the blood of Jesus that washes me from all sin. Father, it's sometimes where we need to start. Father, I just want to be right before you. I want to come before your presence and offer unto you the sacrifice you demanded all of me. And I come, because I'm coming before him in that same fear that they had because they knew what could happen. Believe me, that's pretty intense when you go, okay, we got the two sub-high priests, everything's great. You know, there's Aaron and then his two oldest sons. They're the high priest. These are the guys. There you go. They walk into the presence of God. Boom, they're dead. I'm sure that had an effect on Israel. Whoa, that's intense. So don't go before him and offer your own self in the sense of offer your own ways. Lord, did I not do great things for you today? Come before, offer the offering he's given you, Jesus. Exalt the name of Jesus. That's what you do. If you give something and you're going to say what you gave, then you be truthful. Just be truthful. Just think, don't ever lie. Because you know where liars go? They have their part in the lake of fire. And that's what happens. And they judge. Sometimes people get their judgment now, and sometimes people get their judgment later. But God doesn't treat anybody differently. You lie, that's what the judgment on lying looks like. So we know. Nobody can be confused. That's what it looks like. You may come now, it may come later, but that's the judgment. Just like when you look at Jesus and you look at the crucifixion, that's the judgment on sin. That's what it looks like. It's ugly. It's an ugly mess. God's judgment is pure and it's holy and it's righteous and it's the way it's got to be. That's what we're dealing with. That's what makes what Jesus did for us so much more amazing. Judgment's that harsh. How much more is his mercy that great that he brings us in? So specifically, I cannot tell you. I have no revelation on exactly who Ananias and Sapphira were and what they did. But I can tell you that they lied to the Holy Ghost. And that's what happens to liars. So Father, let me never be one time from this day forward to tell any lie. Not even what I might call a shade of the truth. But let my words be truth, whatever the consequences may be. In Jesus' name. Good question. Anybody have any other questions?
Yes.
Oh.
Matthew 23:9.
Uh-huh. Matthew 23. This is why we have the Word of God. 23, verse 9. Sorry, I'm having a little trouble here. The page is stuck together. Okay. 23:9. Call no man your father upon the earth, for one is your father which is in heaven. Just that. Well, let's go back and look at the context. He's talking about the scribes and the Pharisees. They sit in the seat of Moses. That means they're the representatives of the Mosaic covenant on earth. That's not a light thing. It's a big thing. All therefore what they bid you to observe, you observe it. Do it. But do not after their works, for they say it, but they don't do it. Ooh. I said I would go, but I didn't go. Oh, bad. They bind heavy burdens, grievous to be borne, lay them on men's shoulders, but they will not move one of them with their fingers. Wow, that's pretty intense. All the works they do to be seen of men. Remember we were just reading about that? They make broad their phylacteries. That's those, they would put certain scriptures in these little things to they, because it said bind them on your forehead. So they would literally write the scriptures, put them in a little box and bind it on their forehead. Right? So they make their phylacteries big and noticeable and whatever to try to show men how righteous they were. And they love the uppermost rooms at feasts and chief seats in the synagogues and greetings in the markets and to be called of men, Rabbi, Rabbi. Don't be called Rabbi. One is your master, even Christ, and all are your brethren. Call no man your father upon the earth, for one is your father, which is in heaven. So this likens to what Jesus said when they said, hey, your mother and your brethren stand without, waiting for you. He said, well, who are my mother and my brethren? But them that do the will of the Father. You have one Father who's God. He's your Father. Are you supposed to be honoring your father and mother upon the earth? Yes. It's true. But who's your real Father? He's your Father in heaven. That he gave you the life. And your mother and father gave you a life that was born in sin and iniquity. Right? Well, praise the Lord that you were alive. Praise the Lord they brought you into the earth. That's a great thing. Praise the Lord they didn't abort you or something. But what he's talking about here is it's your Father and it's in heaven. You don't stand before men, you stand before God. And that's really what this is talking about. And that's why the Pharisees did things so that men would see them, so that men would understand what they had done and that they could declare themselves to be special. And that's what he's talking about. Look, you will stand or rise before God. Look to him. He's your Father. And he judges you and he knows what you do and you aren't hiding nothing from him. I can deceive you. You know, I get subtle enough about it, I could deceive you. Devil deceives men all the time. That doesn't make him anything good. That's a horrible thing. I don't ever want to deceive anybody. Father, perish the thought. But, you know, we can deceive men. I can make you think I'm doing really good. I can put on a show for you, make you think I'm doing great, and you could be fooled by it. God is never deceived. Ever. So what he's trying to tell you is, don't be like them to do things before men to earn praise of men. Be like the one who recognizes that God is your Father and he sees it all. That's really what it's talking about. Does that make sense? Everything you do, he knows. Every prayer you pray, he hears. Every thought of your heart, he understands. And he sees your need, and because he loves you so much, he calls you to repentance, and he calls you to change, and he calls you to get it right, and he calls you, and he will patiently and with great long suffering tell you the same thing over and over, and you just don't get it, and he'll just keep on. For the day when you will stop doing whatever it is that's keeping you from moving forward, and you'll stop, and you'll begin to cry out, Lord, obviously, I have not done what I'm supposed to do. Father, forgive me and help me. And then he'll make it right. He will speak his word, and he will come in and make everything right that you were trying so hard to make wrong. That is the miracle of all of this. He will make it right. And I love that word. He speaks his word, and you will stand fast, and the mountains stand fast. He does that to the mountains. He can do that to you. His word. And we need to be those that don't look at people and call them fools and call them bad and call them unworthy and call them unhelpable. We need to be looking at people and going, I have the word of the Lord that will set men free. I speak the word. See, what happens is that we get caught up and say, well, I just got to wait until I've obtained. I got to wait until I've shown myself true. I got to wait until I've accomplished more. I got to wait until, and when we put all these wait untils, because we've got it all figured out how it's supposed to work. And well, if I don't have this, then I can't do that. And then this has got to be in place. And it's all our own way. We don't think it's our own way because we think we have all the right answers. Because after all, we're a teacher to them that know nothing. We know all things and whatever. And we put our own way in place. God just, I can't bless that. Until we get to the point where we go, oh, Father, forgive me. I need what you have. That means I have to devoid myself and deny everything that I have. Father, I don't want anything of myself. And he understands sometimes when we're deceived. I mean, he gets it. He understands that we're deceived. But he's given a cure for the deception. It's his word. His word is truth. So we just got to live according to his word. Got to look at the word. So I look at the word and it says, if I do these things, then will sinners be converted? Well, sinners aren't converted. Then I didn't do those things. And I come back and I say, Lord, I want to do these things so that then I can have. And you begin to cry out. And you don't sit there and go, well, this is how I'm going to do it. Lord, I got a 3-step plan for how I'm going to get myself in the right position to do these things. No, what I'm going to do is I'm going to receive from him. I said, Lord, Father, you've fallen on me broken. Lord, I obviously all my plans have come to nothing, like the plans of the wicked that come to nothing. Oh, Lord. All my plans have come to nothing. Father, I'm going to fall in the wrong. Oh, Father, forgive me. Lord, I don't want to be part of the wicked. I don't want to be one who's cast off because I never knew you. I don't want to be that one. Oh, Father, forgive me. Help me. Strengthen me. I begin to cry out to him. If I weep, I weep. If I sorrow in godly sorrow, I sorrow in God's sight. But when he takes me back to his word, he begins to say, okay, but look at all I did for you. Take a drink of the water. Now out of your belly flows rivers of living water. And now all of a sudden I got joy. Where there was sorrow, and I got blessing, and then I got the word of the Lord, and then I begin to see what the word of the Lord would do. It will change things in my life and in other people's lives. And when I believe that, then I will go with great boldness, and I will speak the word to people, and I will say, in Jesus' name, be set free, and they will happen, and they will stand fast. Because I'm so good, and because his word's that powerful. It's got to be his word, not my word. And when I mixed it with my word, it isn't his word any longer. And it's not in truth, and he's not going to bless it. And it may sound good to men. It may be all put together and sound beautiful and like it's supposed to be, but if it's not changing somebody's life, if it's not doing what God said it's going to do, it wasn't his word. Because his word never fails. Ever. 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 Not one time. He's given us joy and goodness to enjoy. He's given us all good things to enjoy. He wants us to be happy with what he's given us. It's really what he wants us to be. Right? Yeah. So, Father, we thank you for that. In Jesus' name, this is who we are. The greatest soul winners on the planet. Amen. Father, this is who we are. So filled up with your goodness, so filled up with your joy, so filled up with your authority, so filled up with your word, that Lord, that we speak what you said without our own mixture. We speak what we said without our own caveats. We speak what you said and we don't apologize for it. We just speak what you said and we see you do. You told us to preach and signs and wonders would follow. So he told us, Lord, if signs and wonders aren't following, we're not preaching. So, Father, we're going to preach. Well, Lord, but I've been preaching and signs and wonders haven't followed. Well, maybe you're preaching your own word. That's between you and God. You go, but go to him. Father, I want to preach your word in purity. I want to preach your word in purity. I want to preach your word exactly like you said it. In Jesus' name.